Okay, so welcome to Ravensthorpe Reservoir. This is my first walk out of the house since completing my 10-day quarantine. And my first walk ever with my new Insta360. So it's a trial run. I thought that I would take you on a walk that I used to do so many times as a child. So when I was a kid, we had two dogs, Japanese chin dogs, and basically we'd come here a couple of times a week to walk around Ravensthorpe Reservoir. And at the time, you know, it would be my mum, stepdad Merrick, but today it's just me and I'm talking to myself in the middle of nowhere with a new camera. So I just checked that it's still recording. Okay, you know, new piece of equipment, you always get a little bit afraid that it might not actually be working. But it seems to be working. Oh, so, autumn in the UK. It's a shocker for me. It is a shocker. I haven't seen winter in many years. I certainly haven't been below about 16 degrees centigrade in 3 years. So coming back is a little bit, it's a little bit cold, I have to admit. So I thought I'd kick off being back with a nice little walk around the reservoir. You know, all the algae and the dead leaves. And a very British winter scene. And hope there aren't too many fishermen hanging around who are watching me and laughing. But the nice thing about reservoir here, the nice thing about so many parts of the UK is that you can walk out into the middle of nowhere and be completely alone. Oh, look at those beautiful leaves. This is going to get muddy. I may well land on my arse any minute now. But no, it's one of the most wonderful things about coming back to the UK. Listen to this. Oh my gosh. That is so satisfying. Oh, it's beautiful. That's one of the nicest things about coming back to the UK is you can walk out into a field, into any village, anywhere, and be completely alone. Whereas the problem that you have, I love Rwanda very, very much, but it's a hugely densely populated country and, you know, you can't just wander out into a village, you can't wander out anywhere and kind of just find this sort of complete peace and quiet, and especially as a foreigner, as a Mzungu, you attract a lot of attention. So, you know, wherever you go, within a few minutes, you will usually be surrounded. So it's just something that I really, really like about coming back to the UK, and one of the things that I like to do as soon as I get back is just to head out into the middle of nowhere. Let's head out into these forests, into this woodland here. Let's take a little look around. I mean, how beautiful is this? Oh, it looks like somebody's made a little hut here. That is really cute. It's like a little cubby house. They wouldn't set fire to that because, like, the whole thing would go up. Although it's a little bit too wet, I think, to do that. Or some fungus. It's a really, really little beautiful place to go for a walk. head on back to the path. So I meant to do some research before coming because I walk here so often, but I don't, you know, really know much about the history of Ravensthorpe Reservoir. And I was going to look it up because a little further down the path we'll see a really old kind of water works. I want to say Victorian. I'm not sure exactly when it was built. And I did mean to look that up. Oh, Holly, we're getting near the Christmas season. That's kind of apt. Beautiful holly bush. And all of these wonderful vines creeping up the tree. Yeah, so I can't remember when Ravensthorpe exactly was built, but I will look that up and I'll probably either add a bit to the end of this video or some information below that explains a bit more about it. But I do know that the name Ravensthorpe means Raven's Clearing, which is a very cool name. And also there's a bit about the village witches. So there was a Mother Rhodes who was a witch who in the mythology of the local area, she died in Ravensthorpe shortly before her friends from my village were hanged for witchcraft. But I will do a separate video about the witches because it's such an interesting local historical topic. Oh gosh, these are so beautiful, bright yellow. So yeah, that's just another thing really. You know, Rwanda, we don't have seasons like this because we're pretty much on the equator. So sometimes it's a little bit drier in the dry season, sometimes it's a little bit wetter. But things don't really decay, is what I'm saying. You know, kind of they grow all year round. Obviously faster in the wet season. Beautiful bright red berries. You know, you don't... I used to love autumn. When I was a kid, autumn was my favourite time of year. And I love kicking the leaves. I love the smell of it. And then, you know, when I'd been away and been in Rwanda for a few years, I remember when I came back in autumn once, the first time that I came back in autumn in the cold season. And the first thing that hit me was the smell of the decaying leaves. And I realised I actually didn't like it anymore. It really kind of hit me and I realised that, you know, you just don't smell that smell of decay, mould, mildew on the equator. Things don't rot in the same way. Things don't die in the same way. And I kind of, that scent that I really used to love, I suddenly realised I didn't like it anymore, which was a real shock for me. So seasons take a bit of getting used to. I'm definitely getting used to the cold again. It does strange things to your skin. Especially like central heating and hot water showers, like properly hot water showers. So in Rwanda, I take lukewarm showers and it's warm every day and I'm sweating all day, so my skin's always a little bit moister than it is here. So I find I need to use a lot of moisturiser here and lip balm. And weirdly, I was talking to a friend, a lot more deodorant. I think it's because when you're like living in a hot country, you're wearing sort of vest tops and things like that and your sweat evaporates really quickly. Whereas here, it's more kind of, especially in the sort of the cold season, you're wearing thick jumpers, you're wearing thick shirts, and your sweat isn't evaporating so quickly. It's just kind of squelching beneath your sweaters. So definitely need more deodorant. Now this should be good to record for a lot longer now, but I'm just going to stop it and restart again just in case we have any problems. So yeah, hopefully that's caught all of the last piece of the walk. It's got a nice function. You can say, well, I can't say it out loud, otherwise it will do it, but you can say S recording to make it start and stop, which is useful. And it's got a nice little flashing light that tells me it's recording. So far, this is such an easy camera to use. Oh, look, very rusty leaves. Oh, I am enjoying this. It's also very interesting for me because about a few years ago, I split my Achilles, and at the time I wasn't somewhere to get proper medical attention, so I didn't. And it's kind of been healing itself over the past couple of years, but really not very well. And I've always had very strong legs. I've always been able to walk really well. But the past couple of years I haven't, especially in flat shoes, which is what I usually wear. But I'm wearing some trainers with a slight heel today, and I'm bouncing along really, really well. So it's nice because it means that my leg isn't completely gone. Reassuring. Oh, look at the bark on this. Really thick old bark. Nice. Oh, how sturdy do you reckon that is? If I walk on it, are we going to fall off? Let me give it a go. Apparently this camera is also waterproof, so if you end up in the river, that's my fault. That is my fault. Okay. I really want to put you in the water, but I'm just not quite confident enough yet. You can look at the water instead. Look at all of those birds. I don't know how well you can see it, but on the other side of the reservoir is the boathouse where fishermen hire boats and they go out, but there don't appear to be any of them out today. So those birds just in front of us have a little white bit on their heads, and that's coots. If they have a red bit, they're moorhens. So a red cap is a moorhen and a white cap is a coot. And then we've got a mallard in there, a duck. You know, when I was a kid, there was, I can't see it now, there was a little island out there. And one year we had the most incredible drought. And literally I could walk out at least like few yards from here. I mean, it was like everything was mud. Everything was just covered in like cracked dry mud. It was a really bad drought. And then there was another year when we got blue-green algae, and that killed all the fish. And you weren't allowed to walk your dogs in case they accidentally drank it and died. But everything looks pretty good at the moment. It looks like it should do. It's really, really beautiful walk. I do recommend it. And it's an easy walk, you know, the paths are nicely kept. It's not too overgrown. You can meander your way around it quite easily. So if you're in Northamptonshire, passing past Ravensthorpe, get your walking boots on. It will be interesting to see how wobbly this comes out. I think when I get the 360 editing software, I can put like steady cam on it, but I didn't get a gimbal because it said you didn't need one. But if you're feeling seasick at this moment in time, I'm really sorry. I'm still learning what I'm doing. I can't remember what's down that way, but this is the way that we always come. And this old bridge here, so my mum refers to this, Mum and Merrick, they call it, what is it, the dead fish bridge, because when fish die, they tend to end up floating next to the overflow. Oh, Oh, that's overgrown a bit. So when I was a kid, this was all sort of brand, well, not brand new, but it was like, there wasn't any wetland on it, any greenery. But I guess that's better for birds and things. They can nest on it and feed on it. Oh, hello, swan. It's one of the children of Lear come to say hello. But let me just show you down here. But yeah, so if the fish die off, if we have like algae or just if they die naturally, they all tend to kind of get sucked over here. So often when you're crossing, you just see floating dead fish. But there don't appear to be any this time. So it's a beautiful bridge though. So nice. And the water looks nice and clean over this side. It's just a really nice place to come for a walk. And there's a bench over here, and I stopped off on my way to buy a sandwich. I might just sit and have a little bit of my sandwich. And sit and have a little look at the world. Oh, here we go. In memory of Steve Martin, 1944 to 1997. So yes, just going to sit here for a minute and look out at the world and marvel at this camera, because if it does what it says it does, then I should be able to do sort of a shot where you're looking at me and then you're looking out at the reservoir and I don't even have to turn the camera. That would be kind of amazing. Okay, so I've had my pili pili chicken wrap and Turkish delight, and it's time to get going again, but I've had to put on my gloves and my hat because it is brassic here. It is absolutely brassic. So let's continue. Now, I love this part of the walk up here. Let's see if we can get through the gate. Big old clunky gate. And in the countryside, you always have to close your gates properly. But I like this bit. So in summer, you get a lot of fishermen who fish along here, and they cast back their lines over the wall. And so when I was a kid, me and my mum, we would walk along here and I'd always be searching for the little lures that they use on the hooks. So they're usually made out of feathers and they're quite colourful. So red and yellow and black and, you know, really pretty colours. So I used to collect those. Stop and watch the swan for a minute. So I wrote a novel about swans. I did an adult retelling of The Children of Lear. I'll put the link below, why not? So whilst I was eating, I called up Ravensthorpe on Wikipedia and tried to figure out when the reservoir was actually built, but it didn't say. For some reason, it's got sort of about the pub, it's got about the witches, it's got a bit of history, but mostly it's forgotten to mention the giant reservoir. So I will look that up properly when I get home. It's definitely a little bit chilly. Proper British people will be walking around, proper British men in particular, will be walking around in shorts and t-shirt. Northern British men would be walking around in shorts and t-shirt at the moment. If it's not snowing, it's not cold. But for me, having come from the equator, it is definitely not good. Not good. It's not too bad. I'm trying to think what the British standard ratings of cold are. So you've got like Baltic or Brassic, which is really cold. Bracing, which is, bracing is sort of the next not so bad level up. Oh, so this is what makes me think it's Victorian. That looks like a Victorian piece of kit to me. That looks very, very steampunk. Water brought to you by steampunk. I might be wrong, but I feel like that might have been green when I was a kid. Not that it really matters, but it's a nice piece of kit. So yeah, Baltic and Brassic. Then the next level up, well, the milder level up would probably be bracing. Then I guess chilly. So I guess we're at chilly at the moment. Chilly. Yeah, it's not comfortable. It's not Baltic really. It's chilly. Quite an amazing kind of water complex. Also, when I was a kid in summer, you used to see rabbits in there, so hares and rabbits would be running around on the grass. But I think they're probably all down in their burrows at the moment, trying to stay warm. Oh yeah! So also whilst I was eating, I don't know if you can see that right off in the distance, that to me looks like a wind farm. I can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Wahaha. 6 wind turbines, which is quite nice. I know there was a lot of kind of uproar when it was first suggested about kind of everybody wants green energy, but not in my backyard, you know? Can't put the turbines in my fields. I think everybody quite likes them now. I know when they started the wind farm, they offered locals a tour around the wind farm to show people, you know, how the equipment worked, what they were going to do. And I think that changed a lot of people's minds, you know, because they went, they had a proper look at it, they understood how it worked, what it did. And I think that went a long way to kind of convincing the community to welcome the wind farm. I definitely know my mum went to have a look, Mum and Eric. So, yeah. But I like them. I think they're really, yeah, they're really nice. I don't know again if you can see from this distance, but down there on the grass, we've got some like little piles of mud, and those are molehills. So if you ever want to make a mountain, you just need to find one of these and build it up into one. So that's where the moles come up to have a look at the world, decide it's too cold, and then burrow back down again. They should make human-sized ones. So I'm looking at the ground, but I'm not seeing any lures today. I don't think people have been fishing around here for a while. Nice relaxing sound of the water lapping. changes depending on the season so much. So today it's moody and autumny and chilly, and covered in leaves and brown and dark green. But in summer it's the water's really blue. Everything feels very alive. I came here once in summer and there were hundreds and hundreds of dragonflies everywhere. It's like walking through a cloud of dragonflies. Really beautiful. So maybe come back next summer and take another walk around and see if it's changed. Now you can see all of the boats lined up and some weird foam. I've never seen this before. Like shaving foam resting on the water. Let's see what that's about. I love this old mossy wall. That's a proper old Hogwarts style wall. Oh, the sign. Beware casting back, or back casting, sorry, which means that people are casting back their fishing lines, so be careful that you're not standing behind it, otherwise you might get a hook through the nose. What's this bench say? In loving memory of John Pothecary, 1931 to 2014, the perfect partner who spent many happy hours here. I love bench dedications. They're really lovely. Ooh, well that's a little bit stinky. And we're not supposed to go down there. I want, yeah, that's got a really distinctive and slightly unpleasant smell to it. Not entirely sure what's causing that. Oh, here's another one. Three on here. Oh, rest a while in loving memory. Philip Harry Davison and Norma Davison, who died in 2017 and 2018 respectively. Yes, so here are all of the boats lined up. You hire the boats and catch returns, which I think is where you declare what you've caught. And then there is actually a public bathroom here, so if anybody comes walking by, you can stop off for a short call. Always very useful. Oh, look how wonderfully mossy this reef is. Is that okay? There's some steps here in case you decide it's all too much and you just want to walk into the water. You got to head along this narrow path and the big old trees up there, big old pine trees. Nice fluff coming off all of the plants. little jetty for, I guess, launching your boats into. I must admit, although it's cold and I do feel it, I am enjoying it because I'm one of these people, I get quite hot when I exercise and when I walk. And so on a cooler day, it feels a bit more comfortable for me. Once I get moving, my body naturally kind of sorts me out. I'm just glad it hasn't bucketed it down yet. I did ask my mum when I left the house and said, you know, is it likely to rain? Because in Rwanda, the weather is so predictable, so predictable. Usually it's a nice early summer's day, not too hot. And if it's going to rain, you usually get a really strong burst of wind about an hour, 45 minutes before it's about to rain. And you know when that rain comes along that it will probably bucket it down for about an hour, 2 hours tops. So in Rwanda it rains really, really heavily for a short time and you know it's coming because of the wind. So you know, you can really predict the weather with quite a bit of accuracy in Rwanda. Whereas here, I don't know. I asked Mum before coming out, I said, is it likely to rain? And she said, no, it's going to be beautiful and sunny this afternoon. I wouldn't exactly call it that. Ooh, how beautiful. That lake water looks silver. But yeah, so it's definitely got a bit bluer since we started walking. But you know, since I've been back, there's been a lot of rain. A lot of rain, like continuous. Yeah. Some nice blossoms. Look like blackberry blossom, but I don't know if it's a bit too late for that. I don't care where I'm looking, where the camera's looking. It's not too slippy. I can just walk around and talk and enjoy the world around me, knowing that everything is getting captured and hopefully I can put it into something nice later on when I get home. So I feel like I'm recording, but I'm also enjoying the walk and enjoying looking around me. Whereas if I was using a normal camera, I'd constantly be thinking about what I'm looking at and looking at everything through a lens. But at the moment, I'm enjoying this walk through my own eyes, knowing that I can deal with the footage later. If this works, I will be impressed and I will be very, very happy. So that spire, I don't know if you can see the spire, but there's a spire right off in the distance, and that's the church in my home village. So yes. It's just looking over at this field next to us and wondering what is being grown there. I don't entirely recognise it. Some thick leafy vegetable perhaps. If anybody knows, drop it in the comments. Aha! So this side always gets a bit muddy in winter. I haven't got the most waterproof shoes on, I must admit. It doesn't really matter because I'm just going to go home after this and change. I can get as muddy as I like. It is funny though when you come back to places that you've known all your life and remembering walking around places with other people, with the dogs that sort of passed away years ago. Not melancholy exactly, but it's like a memory box. Ooh, a little animal hut here. Don't think anything's in it. Hopefully haven't disturbed anything by peeking inside. Oh, there are some fishermen out there in their boat. Wonder if they're catching anything. This really is kind of watership down country. Merrick said he saw some wild boar the other day, which is very unusual. I know we've had them in the Forest of Dean for many years, but I think we have. But around here, that's really nice, you know, conservation at work. Just bump into badger, mole and toad along here somewhere. Treading a little bit carefully so that I don't land on my arse. Oh, we have to really, don't we? I think we absolutely have to have a little look in here. Oh, big old knotted tree. Love the big old knotted tree. We'll wander through here. You can't see a little side path like that and not go down it really, can you? It's built to be explored. Oh, look. Mushrooms! Oh, I love mushrooms. Sort of always hoping to find a fly agaric or something. You know, those kind of big old red mushrooms with the white dots that gnomes and fairies sit on. Big old pieces of wood. And another holly tree. Oh, and a holly tree with berries on. So holly trees, I believe, are male and female. So the holly bush with the berries, I guess, is the female. And the holly bush without them is the male. I don't think I'm talking crap there. I think that is actually a thing. Male and female holly bushes. Oh, old twisting branches. Oh, when I was a kid, if I came across like a log like this, I would have jumped over it like I was a horse. Little girls in the countryside usually grow up riding horses and pretending to be horses. And then they discover cars. Then they become racing drivers. But yeah, I would spend hours jumping over broom handles pretending to be a horse. Swampy ground. Looks like it could be like a mangrove swamp if it wasn't so bloody cold. I need to just pull my jeans up. It's one of the things that I've noticed since I've been back is that my jeans keep falling down. But that will stop soon because being back I will stuff my face until I am 20 feet wide and then everything will fit. Oh, more mushrooms. There's a mushroom that looks like this but is a bit smaller called probably the honey fungus, and it glows in the dark. I'm just going to switch hands here for carrying my bag and my camera. Some pretty birds flitting ahead of us. Big old fallen tree. Something almost sort of Jurassic World about that. I was just walking around and I noticed these blackberries. And I thought to myself, I wonder what those are. Because, you know, I don't instantly recognize those. And then I remembered that I have got an app on my phone that you point at any plant and it will tell you instantly what it is. So I'm just going to do that. And it's called Picture This. I'll put a link below. But if I take out Picture This and I take a picture, hold on. If I take out Picture This and I take a picture of that plant, it will tell me what it is. Well, it's very difficult to do this one-handed. And without an internet connection, apparently. Poor connection. So apparently I've got no internet this far around the reservoir. But what I will do is I will run it when I get back and figure out exactly what that plant is. Technology incredible. When I was a kid, I used to walk around with all of these, oh, there's some more of it, all of these identification, nope, that's a different plant with blackberries. Is it? I don't know. But I used to walk around with all of these identification books, trying to figure out what plants were. And now I just point my phone at it and it tells me. And my friend Solvay and I were in a restaurant in Kigali a little while back, and they'd used plastic plant all the way up one of the walls, and it was even able to recognize the type of plant that the plastic plant had been based on, which I think is pretty amazing, pretty good going. So it not only told me what it was, but also told me how to water it and take care of it and how much light it needed. Yes. Okay, so this is a plant I do know. So you have stinging nettles, and you have this, which is something angel, white angel or something, sweet angel. So it looks like a stinging nettle, but it isn't. It has white flowers. And if you pick the white flowers out, then you put them in your mouth, and they're like honeysuckle. They're the same as honeysuckle. You get a really sweet little taste at the end of it. It's really nice. So one or two I do remember. Well, we're coming towards the end of the grassy part at the moment, coming towards the road, because I can hear traffic in the distance. Again, I do like this, that you can just walk around talking to yourself in the middle of nowhere, nobody asking what you're doing, nobody following you. Well, I hope that there's nobody following me, but that would be a bit creepy. But know that you just have the space just to exist and be alone with your thoughts. In the wild, in the wilderness. This is pretty. The colour of the world just reflecting off that surface is beautiful. It's like one of those scrying mirrors, like the obsidian black mirrors. You just see the ripples. There's even a little place to sit down here. I'll try it. Oh, that's lovely. What a lovely little spot. Got a little coot swimming through the branches. Fallen leaves in the water. Oh, this is beautiful. Oh, This is a kind of a level of relaxation I haven't felt for a long time. Stop to pull my jeans up again. Oh, this is a nice tree. It's got some bright orange on it, which I initially thought was lichen, but I think it's actually paint. I saw it on some trees as we were starting out earlier, and I think that they're marking the trees for some reason. There's also a metal tag on it. I don't quite know what that means, but it's interesting. But I think that's too bright orange to be something terribly natural. Oh, there's another little siding here. Oh, we need to duck under here and see where it goes. Whoopsie. Oh wow, okay. Well, it's a field. That's the nice thing around here. So in England, there's a lot of trespassing laws, so you have to be a bit careful about where you walk. If you're in Scotland, I don't think there is any law of trespass, so long as you're not criminally damaging anything, like crops, or scaring the wildlife, you're allowed to walk where you like in Scotland. But here, most of the land is owned by people who don't mind you walking on it. A lot of it's owned by the Lowthers, and we'll go on another walk on their land later, but they don't mind people walking on it. And I think that's very nice, and that's important, because too often people move to the countryside and it's like ownership, it's claiming things, it's like, this is mine, keep off, nobody's allowed on it. Whereas that's not really what the countryside's about. How are we going to get across here? It's going to be fun. You know, people live on the land, and the land was here before you were born, and it'll be here long after you die. And everybody has the right to it, really. To walk on it, to enjoy it, so long as they're not damaging things or stealing things, then why would you get precious about it? It's not really an ownership symbol. This could be fun. Oh, there we go. And I think a lot of the older landowners, you know, if land has been in families for many generations, people kind of know that. It's, you're kind of caretaking the land rather than owning it. And you know, you only caretake something and look after something so that people can use it and enjoy it. A nice bench over here. Oh, that's nice. What's that? Is that I'm very, very bad at identifying trees. I know oak trees, I know silver birch trees. This is that just a normal bird? No. Huh. Got like miniature pine cones on it. Oh. And here's another view. Okay, that was nice. There's a couple just gone past walking their dog, and it's nice in the countryside because everybody just says hello. It's like, hello, hello. But we better get a bit of a shimmy on, see whether or not my battery whether or not I can get all the way around here on one battery or not. Just had a bit more of a sandwich. Big old polypore mushroom. There are birch polypores, and once you dry them, you can sharpen knives on them. They get solid, and you can sharpen your knives. So we're here, we're coming to the end of the woodland part. So from this point on, we're going along the road. So I'm probably just going to shorten this a little bit, so that it doesn't look so obvious that I'm filming. But through we go. And on the other side of the road is a non-public area, which is a nature reserve and wildlife area. Now it's a bit dangerous along here because cars come along so fast. There's another one coming, so you have to be a bit careful. Traffic in Rwanda doesn't move that fast. That is one thing that scares me to death when I'm in the UK, is the speed of traffic, how fast people drive. So like in Africa, driving is a bit more chaotic. You know, people don't always stick to the rules. It's not always as organized, but people move a lot more slowly. They're a bit more forgiving. And everything usually works itself out. Whereas here, everything is extremely orderly. Mistakes are not easily forgiven. But people go at mad speed. Like, whew, it's a lot. So when you're walking along the road, if you don't already know this, always walk into traffic so that they can see your face as they're coming towards you. So walk on the side of the road where the traffic's coming towards you. Yeah, no, it's especially in country lanes, it's quite scary. You can get into a bit of trouble with the speed of traffic. Oh look, there's so many of these blackberries. God, they're everywhere. You also find an awful lot of roadkill along here, well, along any road in the countryside. We went down one the other day and there were two full-size badgers. It's a little bit upsetting. There's a gap in the hedge over there, so we'll just pop over and have a little look at the water sanctuary, the nature reserve. There's nothing coming. Here we go. So this is the part that's not open to the public. I think there's another swan over there, a young swan. A lot of more coots. I think the coots have taken over the reservoir. You sometimes see grey heron. Sometimes see moorhen. There's some ducks flying overhead. Seagull. More ducks. So yeah, it's good that wildlife is being protected. Oh, and then this is the side that we've just walked around. So we've just walked all the way around that bit there. So when we were crossing the dead fish bridge, oh, car coming by. So when we were crossing the dead fish bridge, and the water pumping station, that's directly opposite us over the other side. there's somebody there doing some fishing. So yeah. Somebody going for a cycle. Must be bloody cold. Hello.
Okay.
So yeah, it's really nice. People in villages are friendly usually. And a bus, yeah. Because why not? Oh dear. Right, we're almost back where we started. I didn't actually show you the gate when we began the walk because a guy in an Audi TT pulled up and he was eating a sandwich with his engine running, and I felt a little bit self-conscious about getting the camera out and filming whilst he was sitting there eating and watching. But hopefully when we come back into the car park I can show you where we very very first began, and it'll be like a kind of a full circle of life. Blackberries. That was blackberry blossom earlier. I can't say that. Blackberry blossom. So yes, that was indeed blackberry blossom. There's quite a lot of it over there. Brambles, as we call it. From which my nana used to make the most incredible bramble jelly, which is just blackberry jam. But it wasn't just blackberry jam, it was incredible. That's a little shortcut through here. Here we go. And down to where it all began, where my car is the only one left in the car park. Oh, bless. This is my car, Kitty. She's named after Kitty Butler from Flipping the Velvet, which was a starring role for Keeley Hawes. And this is where we began. So this is the gate that I originally went through when we set off and began our walk. But I didn't show you because of the guy in the Audi TT and my own self-consciousness. We'll come back to the ducks in a moment, but something that I noticed is that they've put up a sign up here which actually shows you the walk around, and that wasn't there before. So that's quite good. So when I was a kid, let the van go by. When I was a kid, you used to need a permit, or you were supposed to have a permit to walk around this. But they've got rid of that now and let anybody come. Which I think is good and important, because people should get out in the countryside and enjoy it. Sorry, I said that very forcefully. You have to enjoy it. No, just get out, enjoy it, walk. So yeah. I didn't know, but parts of this have actually got names. So we've got Tall Willows, The Clump. Oh, the island was the bit that dried up years ago. Dam Wall, Munger Bank. My entire life I had no idea that that part was called Munger Bank. I didn't know that parts of this reservoir had names, and I don't think they did. I think they have simply put these names up here now so that it makes it sound a bit more mysterious, I guess. I like this sign here that says no open fires, because the chance of starting a fire when it's this damp and wet is negligible. So anyway, that was Ravensthorpe Reservoir, and we'll just finish off with a quick look at the ducks. There's a sign back there. Apparently the car park is closed at 4 p.m. I don't know if it's open later in summer, At the moment it gets dark at 4:30 at night because we're in winter. So maybe in the summer it's open later. Oh no, I feel so damn guilty. Hello darlings. See, they're running towards me because people come here with bread to feed them. You see they're coming towards me? And I didn't bring any bread, which makes me a really bad human being. And I would not be surprised if the ducks overpower me, drag me to the ground, and peck me to death and then consume my body. I think that would be perfectly legitimate, to be honest, as I haven't brought them anything. So yeah, we've got some mallards and some ducks and a swan over there who's followed me partway around this reservoir and given me the evil eye for not feeding. And what appears to be, I don't know, are they seagulls or petrels? What's the difference between a seagull and a petrel? I don't know. For somebody who grew up in the countryside, I am woefully useless at identifying plants or animals. Bloody hell, what was that? I'm going to move back a little bit because swans can be a little bit terrifying. And I don't have anything to feed you, sweetheart. I have nothing. Okay. Yep, we're done. If I'd just stayed still and filmed that, I'm sure that would have looked beautiful. But I was afraid of the swan because they can break people's arms. It's not quite as terrifying as a hippo coming out of the water, but they're still pretty powerful birds. But if I'd stayed still and filmed that properly, it might have looked really nice. Okay, bye bye, lovelies.